The story which we are going to do today is the singing lesson by Catherine Mansfield. Right? We'll discuss the theme of the story and other things in detail after we finish the story, or rather when we come across that theme in the story. But first, we'll start with the introduction of the author. Who will read? Kritika, please read. Kritika Saxena.
Catherine Mansfield Marie, 14 October 1888, well in 10 New Zealand, 9 January 1923, Fontainebleau, France, was a prominent modernist short story writer who was born and brought up in colonial New Zealand and wrote under the pen name of Catherine Mansfield. At 19, Mansfield left New Zealand and settled in the United Kingdom, where she became a good friend of modernist writers such as D.H. Lawrence and Virginia Woolf. In 1917, she was diagnosed under extra pulmonary tuberculosis, which led to her death.
Commonly known as TB, right? It's a disease of the lungs.
Which led her to the death at the age of 34 in 1923. Catherine Mansfield's brief life was a lesson in casting off.
So she died quite young. When she was 34 years old, she died, right? And she was a friend to great writers like D.H. Lawrence and Virginia Woolf. They were very great writers as far as psychological novel is concerned. Right? They were very famous. So Catherine Mansfield was their friend. So read for them.
Famously, Mansfield remarked, risk everything. In the world of one of her biographers, it was largely through her adventurous spirit, her eagerness to grasp at experience and to succeed in her work, that she became ensnared in disaster. If she was never a saint, she was certainly a martyr and a heroine in her recklessness, her dedication, and her courage. Catherine Mansfield revolutionized the 20th century English short story. Her best work shakes itself free of plots and endings and gives the story, for the first time, the expansiveness of the interior life, the poetry of feeling, the blurred edges of personality. She is taught worldwide because of her historical importance, but also because of her prose offers lessons in entering ordinary life that was still vivid and strong. And her fiction retains its relevance through its open-endedness, its ability to raise discomforting questions about identity, belonging, and desire. The Singing Lesson is a short story in the collection of The Garden Party and Other Stories of Catherine Mansfield, published in 1922.
This story which we are going to do today is a short story which is a part of this collection, right? She wrote a collection of short stories titled as The Garden Party and Other Stories, and this story is a part of that collection.
In it, the themes of despair, sadness, reliance, appearance, desperation, and happiness are explored in the character of a protagonist.
So appearance versus reality is one theme of this story. Can you tell me of any other story which had a similar theme? Appearance versus reality.
Ma'am, the blue bead.
The Chinese statue.
The Chinese statue in this. As far as your syllabus of class 12 is concerned. So Chinese statue also had a similar theme. Appearance versus reality. What appears may not be the true thing. Despair and dejection is another theme, and the third important theme is reliance and appearance. Right? desperation. We'll come to know about the desperation of Miss Meadows. You will understand these themes better once we start with the story. Anusha, please read.
Yes, ma'am. With despair, cold, sharp despair, buried deep in her heart like a wicked knife, Miss Meadows, in cap and gown and carrying a little baton, trod the cold corridors.
What is the meaning of a baton? Hall. Baton or baton, you can pronounce it both ways. So what is the meaning of baton?
Ma'am, a thin stick which is used by a conductor to means while singing to instruct.
If you're pronouncing it as E, then you have to keep in mind.
From a cylindrical club made of wood.
Instruct the musicians.
Yes, it's used in music. It's a club kind of a thing. And it's used to play music. While playing music, it is used. If you're pronouncing it as A, B, Tan, then it will be Tan and Baton. Baton, actually, it's like this. And if you're pronouncing it as Bad, then it will be Baton. Right? So that's the difference of two different, I mean, the same word being pronounced differently in different parts of the world. Baton, carrying a little baton. So she was a music teacher with despair, cold, sharp despair, right? So again, you can judge the atmosphere of the entire story from these words. So these beginning 3-4 words, you will come to know the entire setting of the story. What is the type of environment? What kind of picture is the writer trying to portray? A very sad, right? He's talking about sadness. You can have an idea of the upcoming things, right? That nothing happy is about to happen in the near future. Because the first words of the story, they are talking about despair and not despair. Then the words are, he stresses on that particular word, despair. She says, it's Catherine Mansfield. So she says, cold, sharp despair. Right? Cold, sharp despair. Despair means sadness, sorrow, right? And then cold, sharp despair means going to the extent of hopelessness, a deep feeling of hopelessness that now nothing can be done. Deep sorrow, he's talking about great hopelessness. Buried deep in her heart like a wicked knife. Which figure of a speech has been used here?
Personification.
Come again, Anusha.
Personification.
Why? Achha, wicked knife.
Simile.
And simile is also there, right? Like a wicked knife. The knife is wicked because it cuts, right? It causes pain. So that despair was deeply rooted or buried deep inside Miss Meadows' heart, right? What does it mean? That her mood is not okay. She's in great sorrow. She's in great despair. She's feeling dejected, but she has buried that feeling deep inside her. That is something which will not be obvious, will not be visible to others. Are you getting the point? Heart like a wicked knife, Miss Meadows in cap and gown and carrying a little baton, trod the cold corridors that led to the music hall. So she was coming down the cold corridors. The corridors were cold. It means that the time of the year is winter. See, in this story, like in most of the other stories, the writer has tried to relate the atmosphere to the mood of the protagonist. Right? actually what she has tried to depict is whatever is inside will come out in some or the other way. Like this happens with every one of us. If we are not in a good mood, if you have got a scolding from your parents at home and you go to school carrying that baggage, what will you do? You'll not talk to your friends properly, right? Sit in one corner of the class, enter into an argument or fight with some other of your friends or colleagues. This is how we behave generally. See, these people, that is Catherine Mansfield, D.H. Lawrence, Virginia Woolf, they wrote on a particular theme, that is stream of consciousness. They were psychological writers, especially D.H. Lawrence and Virginia Woolf. They had a deep insight into the psychology, human psychology, right? How a human mind functions. So this story also deals with these things. Trod the cold corridors. Trodding means walking, right? She was walking through the cold corridors that led to the music hall. She was a music teacher because she was carrying a backpack. So obviously you can make out from these words. An English teacher will not carry a backpack, right? So she was a music teacher and she was moving towards the music hall, which makes it very obvious that she has to do something related to music. Girls of all ages, rosy from the air. Rosy from the air means, I told you, the four mentioned lines, they tell us about the weather, that it was cold because it was the winter season, most probably. So, the girls of all ages, now these girls is a reference to the students of different ages belonging to different classes, rosy from the air, and their cheeks, they were rosy because of the cold air. Right? When you go to places where the wind is very cold, what will happen? After some time, your nose, tip of the nose will become red and your cheeks will be red. They turn red, even your fingertips also. Right? So, trod the cold corridors that led to the music hall. Girls of all ages, rosy from the air and bubbling with the gleeful excitement that comes from running to school on a fine autumn morning. It was autumn, right? Winters were approaching. So, on a fine autumn morning. So, it was morning, autumn morning. In autumn also in European countries, it's pretty cold, right? So, the winds is harsh, cold, and so autumn morning, hurried, skipped, fluttered by. So, in the morning, the girls of different ages, there was a gleeful excitement. Gleeful means very happy and joyous, right? They were in a very happy mood and very excited, talking to their friends. You can imagine these things, like this is how you people also behave in the school, right? So, there was a gleeful excitement among the students. They came from running to school because most of them came walking or running to school in excitement. So, from running to school on a fine autumn morning, right? So they must be walking and running to school, and so they were very excited. It was autumn morning, and then when you walk and run, you need to brisk walk and you run, then you start feeling a bit hot. And so they were excited, hurried, skipped, fluttered by. So they were running here and there, skipping, jumping, and fluttered by. Fluttered again means to move very quickly. They were moving very quickly, right? Here and there, all over the place, there were students there. From the hollow classrooms came a quick drumming of voices. means the sound like drum was coming from the hollow classroom. Hollow classroom means classrooms which were in a hollow, right? So, quick drumming of voices, a bell rang, and then there was the school bell which rang. A voice like a bird cried, "Mirit." And then there came from the staircase a tremendous knock, knock, knock. Someone had dropped her dumbbells, right? So what happened? So somebody called out. So this is the description. In the first paragraph, the environment has been described. Everything what was happening there has been described. Now see, two different types of moods have been described by the author. One is of Miss Meadows, who is in great despair. She's coming to school. Her heart is suffering from a lot of pain. She is carrying a lot of pain, which has been compared to a wicked knife buried inside her heart. Then the another description is of the girls, that is the students, who are very active, very lively, very agile, chirping, running here and there, skipping. So these words, what are these words telling us? What feeling are they trying to depict? Can anyone tell me? Feeling of happiness, sadness, feeling of life, full of life. What is it? Nobody.
Happiness.
The girls, the students there, that is the young girls who are coming to school to study, they are full of life, full of energy. And when you are full of energy, you cannot be different. You definitely cannot be sad. Right? These two things cannot happen together. Lively, being very active, and then sad also. So, came quick drumming of voices. Then sound similar to the drums came from the classrooms. A bell rang, and then the ringing sound of the bell was heard. And then a voice like a bird cried. Muriel. So this was somebody cried this name. And then there came from the staircase. And then the next sound which was heard was somebody coming down the stairs, coming down the staircase, a tremendous knock, knock, knocking. So the tapping of the shoes or the sandals which the person wore was heard. That was knock, knock, knocking. The sound is, which figure of his speech is it? Someone had happened to, had dropped her dumbbell. So, sorry. Came from the tremendous knock, knock, knocking. So somebody had dropped the dumbbells. This was the sound of the dumbbells, sorry. Knock, knock, knocking. This sound was of the dumbbells, right? So the dumbbells must have been dropped, and then somebody came down the staircase, maybe to pick it up or whatever, right? So both the sounds were held. Knock, knock, knocking sound was of the dumbbells being dropped. You know what are dumbbells? What are dumbbells?
From that we
using gestures to tell me the meaning of dumbbells.
From there, the weights used in
yes, here. Right.
Yes, weight.
So those are the dumbbells. The science mister stopped this minute. And then what happened? When these things were going on in the surrounding, the first paragraph talks about the atmosphere. Then what happened all of a sudden? The science mister stopped this minute. Miss Meadows, who was completely lost in her own thoughts, in her despair, in her sorrow, her mind was completely occupied with some sad thing which must have happened in her life. We'll come to know about it later, right? So something sad happened in her life and her mind was completely engrossed in it. Then what happened all of a sudden? The science teacher stopped Miss Meadows, right? She was stopped by the science teacher. "Good morning," she cried in her sweet, affected drawl. Drawl means drawlings means when you stretch a particular word, like the way you wish good morning. "Good morning, ma'am," right, in school. And that is something which has been happening from the ages and ages hence, and I hope the coming generations will also follow this custom and tradition. I don't know why they are so fond of dragging this particular word. Good morning. Good morning. Morning too is a stretch even further. They can stretch it to the next morning. So normally when the drawl is when you stretch the vowel sounds a lot, right? So in the vowel sounds are stretched, so that is drawling. While speaking, when you stretch them, okay? Or take too much time to utter the vowels, then it is drawling. Affected drawl. Isn't it cold? It might be winter. So what did she say? First she said good morning, in her same style, where in which she dragged all the vowels in good morning, good and more, right? So in that style, affected means, what do you mean by affected here? Affected manners, affected drawl. Affected means something which is not natural, right? Some unnatural way of, so the good morning should be wished as good morning. This is a natural way of wishing good morning. But then dragging it is something which is affected, right? Which is not natural, doesn't come naturally to you, right? So in her own sweet and affected manner, she said, good morning, she wished good morning. Isn't it cold? It might be winter. So then she said to Miss Meadows that, isn't it cold? I hope the winters have already come. So it's almost winter now because the wind is very cold. Miss Meadows hugging the knife. See, she is not actually carrying a knife, right? This is just a comparison. Hugging the knife means trying to hide the pain which she was having, which she was carrying inside her heart. You cannot carry a knife in your heart. Literally, it's not possible, right? Miss Meadows hugging the knife is stared in here. Hugging the knife here means that she tried to hide her despair, her sorrow. Why? Because she didn't want the science mistress, that is the science teacher, to know about it. So she became alert. She became cautious that her behavior should not make it obvious to the science teacher that she is not normal at the present moment. She's not okay at the present moment. This is what we do when we try to hide our pain and sorrow from someone else, right? So Miss Meadows, hugging the knife, stared in hatred at the science teacher. And then, though she tried to hug the knife and protect it and make it less obvious, but still her eyes made it obvious and she looked at the science teacher with hatred. Everything about her was sweet, pale like honey. So everything about her means everything about the science teacher. As it is, you can now understand what type of a person the science teacher would have been from these words, affected drawl. Right? So I hope you have an idea, na? What type of a person she is. She must be a lady of affected manners, trying to show off. That kind of a lady she must have been, right? There are people who talk very sweetly and they are the first ones to criticize you when you move away from their surrounding, right? But in front of you, they will speak as if they are the only ones who love and care for you, right? So I think you can make out this about the science teacher. The science mistress. Everything about her was sweet, pale like honey. So the writer has also given a description that everything about the science teacher or the science mistress was very sweet and pale like honey. Like honey is something which is very sweet. You would not have been surprised to see a bee caught in the tangle of that yellow hair. A bee caught in the tangle of that yellow hair. In the tangles of that hair, yellow hair means anyone can be deceived by her manner. Okay. I told you, like you feel about these people that they are the only well-wishers you have, but then they will be the first ones to stab your back. So that is the meaning of this line. It's rather sharp, said Miss Meadows grimly. Grimly means seriously and in a very sad manner, with a very serious and sad expression. She said that yes, it's rather sharp. The weather is sharp, means the wind is sharp. It's like not very pleasant. The other smiled her sugary smile. Her smile was also sugary. So she smiled her pleasant sugary smile. You look frozen, she said. Her blue eyes opened wide. There came a mocking light in them. And then she said, you look frozen. Why was she looking frozen? Why was Miss Meadows looking frozen?
Because she was sad.
Yes.
And was hiding some type of grief in her heart.
Yes. So, see, when our mind is completely occupied with something, sorrow is something which doesn't leave you easily. As you remember in Tempest also, said that a sorrowful heart, it's very difficult for a sorrowful heart to fall asleep. For whom were these lines used?
King Alonso.
And who used them?
When he lost for the
Gonzalo.
No, not Gonzalo. Gonzalo didn't say that.
Caliban.
No, I think it was either Antonio or Sebastian. Because he said that my eyes are heavy now and I want to fall asleep. Right? So, sorrow is something which has a very strong impact on you. When you are sad, your mind is completely obsessed and completely occupied with if some tragedy happens in a person's life. Right? So that is maybe that is the reason, and the other reason could be the weather also. Right? You look frozen means there is no expression in on your face. She was not smiling also. She was not looking in a very happy mood also. So she was not happy at that time. So you look frozen, she said. So she smiled her sugary smile and then she said, you look frozen, Miss Meadows. Her blue eyes opened wide and her blue eyes, she had blue eyes which opened wide and then there came a mocking light in them. Mocking light means trying to make fun of, like trying to ridicule the other person. Had she noticed anything? And then what will happen? See, if you are trying to hide something from the rest of the world and there is a mocking expression, the mocking smile on the person's face, right? And the person says like, also, you look frozen, what's wrong? You look so sad, what will happen? Earlier it has been mentioned that she was hugging that knife. The moment she saw the science teacher, she hugged that knife, means she became very alert and cautious about the expression of her sorrow, that she has to control herself. She didn't want that everyone else or the science mistress or any other person should be aware of what's going inside her. So what will happen when the person will talk like this? You look frozen. And then there will be a mocking light in them, mocking light in their eyes. So like, is there something wrong with you? So then what will go in the other person's head? Does she know anything about my pain? Does she know anything what happened to me? I wish. Like, see, these are the thoughts which occur to everyone's head, right? Suppose the students do anything wrong and then they come to know that the teacher has called them in the staff room. Maybe the teacher is completely oblivious of everything. She doesn't know what mischief you committed. But then by the time you will reach that staff room, a thousand thoughts will enter your mind. You will even think about the explanation which you are going to offer to the teacher. Why and under what circumstances you committed that particular mischief? Yes or no? Right? And then you go there and you come to know that no, the story was entirely different. She had called you for something else. So, this was what was going on Miss Meadows' head. That had she noticed anything? Had she noticed anything? Had she noticed that I'm sad, that I'm not happy? Does she have some idea about what happened to me or what went wrong with me? So these were the thoughts which were coming in Miss Meadows' mind. Any problem till here? So had she noticed anything? Oh, not quite as bad as that, said Miss Meadows. So, and she gave the science mistress in exchange for her smile a quick grimace and passed. So what she wanted to do at the present moment, she wanted to run away from there, right? She was kind of trying to avoid the company of the science mistress. Why? Like I gave you the example of you committing a mischief and the teacher calls you. And then you come to know that, no, the story was something different. The teacher wanted to tell you some other story. Then also, to be on the safe side, what you want to do is, you immediately do the work for which you have been called and you run away from there. Right? In any other situation, you can tell the teacher about some other stuff. But in this, when you know that you have committed some serious offense, then you want to run away. Why? Just to save yourself. You want to avoid even the slightest possibility of the teacher coming to know about that particular thing which you are trying to hide. So she said, oh, not as bad as that. So she said, you look quite frozen. So the way these people, they talk, show off a lot. And then she said, Miss Meadows said that, no, it's not that bad. I'm not that cold. I'm not feeling that cold, said Miss Meadows. And she gave the science mistress in exchange of her smile a quick grimace. Grimace means?
Smile.
When you like twist your face a lot, right? Not a very pleasant expression, that is a grimace, right? In the expression normally to show anger or disgust, that is grimace, right? When you frown. So she gave the science mistress was there standing in front of her with a sugary smile. And in exchange of that smile, what did Miss Meadows give? She gave her a grimace, right? She frowned and twisted her face. And then she passed on. She passed on means she went away from there. She left. Forms 4, 5, and 6 were assembled at the music hall. So forms here means the classes. Right? The students of classes 4, 5, and 6. They had gathered in the music hall. The noise was deafening. You must be aware of this fact. This doesn't need any explanation. You know the noise which you create. And here there were 3, 4, 5, and 6. 3 classes were assembled. So you can very well imagine the deafening noise which must have been created by these students. On the platform by the piano stood Mary Beasley, Miss Meadows' favorite, who played accompaniment. So there on the stage stood Mary Beasley. Mary Beasley is the name of a student, right? So he stood there on the platform. She was the favorite student of Miss Meadows, who played accompaniment. Accompaniment means, what do you mean by accompaniment? Something this person has written, right? Accompaniment normally means the musical instruments which are played. Na? When the singer sings, so the musical instrument which is played along with the person singing a song. So those are accompaniments. So she stood there. She was the favorite student of Miss Meadows and she used to play accompaniments. That is the music was played by her whenever Miss Meadows taught a song or was singing a song. She was turning the music stool. And what was she doing on the stage? She was turning that stool. That stool which was there, kept on the platform. When she saw Miss Meadows, she gave a loud warning. girls. So again, you must be very well acquainted with this, right? So the moment, because she was standing on the platform, so she must have been the first one to see this meadow entering the hall, right? Because she was the only, she must have been the only one to whom the entrance of the hall must be visible, right? She was facing the girls, and the back of the rest of the girls must be, must have turned their back towards the entrance. So the moment she saw Miss Meadows entering the hall, she asked, she warned the girls loudly, she warned the girls, shh. Girls, keep quiet, right? And Miss Meadows, her hands thrust in her sleeves. Thrust in her sleeves means like this, right? When you just hold both your hands and then you, like this. It's not visible. When you fold your hand like this, right, and stand, so this is thrusting in your sleeve. Because her full sleeves if the person wears, and it doesn't mean that the hands have been put inside the sleeves. Right? So, thrust in her sleeves, the baton under her arm, and then the baton was under her arm. Strode down the central aisle. What is an aisle? You must have studied this word in Heart and Hand. See, I even yes, tell sir. You the place where you have come across a particular
walking
word.
Path.
Huh?
In the hallway. Walking path in the hallway.
Passageway.
Yes. Right? The path which is, it's aisle is there in the train also. In her Hearts and Hands, you came across this word, aisle. Right? So the path, small, a narrow path which is there for the people to walk. So the center aisle mounted the steps. So there was some space which was left in the middle of the hall for the people to walk easily. So she walked through that, and then she boarded the steps of the platform, mounted the steps. Turned sharply, and then she gave a sharp turn. She turned quickly, seized the brass music stand, and then she caught hold of the music stand, which was made of brass, planted it in front of her, and then she lifted it up and kept it in front of her, and gave two sharp taps to the baton for silence. And then on that music stand, she tapped the baton which she was carrying twice, which meant, what was the meaning of that tapping?
Silence.
Silence, right? So she wanted the girls to be quiet, right? Or to maintain silence. That is why she tapped the baton twice. Silence, please, immediately. So then she said, I want all of you to maintain silence immediately. Means quickly, keep quiet. And looking at nobody, her glance swept over that sea of colored flannel blouses and bobbing pink faces and hands. So then she didn't look at anyone. She was not looking to any particular student, any particular girl which was standing in front of her. So her glance swept over that sea of colored flannel blouses. It's a description of the uniform which the students were wearing, right? So they were, the uniform was colored. It was made of flannel blouses. So it means, see, flannel is a material which is, it's a type of a cloth, flannel cloth. It's a type of a cloth which is made by mixing cotton and wool. When both these things are mixed, normally for light winters, you wear flannel light winter with bobbing pink faces. Bobbing pink means, bobbing means moving here and there, not static. The girls, it's very difficult for them not to fidget. They were very young students. Hear about young students. You people fidget so much in the class. So they were like the students of 4, 5, and 6, yes. They were the students of 4, 5, and 6. So you can imagine their ages, right? Normally 7, 8, 9 years of age. So it's very difficult for them to remain still. So they were moving their heads here and there, bobbing their pink faces. Why pink faces? Because of the cold, right? And the people in those countries are very fair, so they turn pink more quickly, right? So they are bobbing pink faces, means the faces, their pink faces moving here and there. And hands, quivering butterfly hair bows. So they must be wearing, the hair bows must be the part of the uniform. And so quivering. And when they were bobbing their faces, that when they were moving their faces here and there, then the butterfly hair bows which they must be wearing on their heads, it must be moving. Quivering means shaking, moving. So it also must be moving. And moving book and music books outspread. And what else was there? The music books, they were spread. Right? They were opened. She knew perfectly well what they were thinking. Miri is in a wax. So she understood very well what these girls standing in front of her, what they must be thinking. They must be thinking that Miri is in a wax. Miri is for Miss Vedas. Like, students are very fond of giving nicknames to their teacher, right? They give names to their teacher. Again, a very popular custom which has been followed from several ages. I don't know it's when it started, but then they give names to their teacher. We also did. You must have also done or are still doing. And the people in future, they will also give names to their teacher. So she understood what these girls are standing in front of her, what they must be thinking. They must be thinking Miri is in a wax. And to be in a wax means to be upset, right? So these girls must be thinking that today she is upset. Miss Meadows is upset. Right? See, the students are very smart. They can easily judge the mood and the temperament of the teachers, right? And that is how they behave. If they will, the teacher enters the class and she is very serious and annoyed, then everything will fall in place immediately. They will be like, they will not try to annoy her further, right? But once they are able to find out that she is in a good mood, so after that, they consider it their birthright to pester her to death. Fine, how dare you enter our class in such a good mood? Now take it from us. Right? So Miri is in a wax means they understood that she is not happy today. She is sad. Well, let them think it. So then she thought that let them think whatever they want. I don't care. Her eyelids quiver. So her eyelids also started shaking. She tossed her head, defying them. Defying them means without paying any heed to them. Disregarding them, disregarding their presence. First, the moment she glanced, the people standing in her class, that is the students in her class, she didn't look at anyone in particular. She looked at them in general. So then the thought which occurred to her head was that they must be thinking that I am sad today, I am upset today. Right? These students must be thinking this about me. Then the immediate thought that came next was that let them think what they want. Right? I'm not going to pay any heed to what they feel about me or what they think about. Her eyelids quivered. And when she was thinking about all these things, her eyelids quivered and she tossed her head. Tossed her head means she just turned her head. She just moved her head. Defying them means disregarding them. Right? It was an expression of disregard towards the girls which were standing in front of. What could the thoughts of those teachers matter to someone who stood there bleeding to death? Again, an expression for her sorrow, right? How does it matter what these girls are thinking about me when I am here bleeding to death? When my sorrow is killing me, when my sorrow is great enough to kill me, Why should I care about what others are thinking about me? Pierced to the heart by such a letter. So the letter which I received, it pierced my heart. It hurt me to the core of my heart. I was deeply hurt. So these words are telling, these words and phrases leading to death, sorry, pierced to the heart. Again, there is a stress on the same phrase, to the heart. Means deep down within the heart, I can feel the pain. I can feel the sorrow. The writer is trying to express the damage which this particular letter, we'll come to know about the contents of the letter later on, right? This particular letter, the damage which that letter has made to Miss Meadows' heart. How she was damaged from inside. How deeply her feelings were hurt. How deeply her emotions were hurt on getting that letter. Right? I think we should stop here. We'll continue from here on the next time. If you have any problem, you can ask.